Good morning. And grace and peace to you. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We welcome you to our worship service here this morning. Special welcome to any guests or visitors who might be with us today. We'd encourage you, as well as everyone, to sign in on the registration cards found in the pews. We'd like to welcome your being with us. We also welcome you to stay for today, as we won't have coffee and fellowship, but the FOC is having a brunch, and they'll talk more about that later. Also want to draw your attention to a couple things in the bulletin, and also welcome those who are listening in to our videotape ministry, those at Sibley Specialty Care, Countryview Manor, and Hartwood Heights. For this morning, you may have already noticed, we do have a baptism. We also have, want to recognize that there is chancel choir practice after the service today for those of you involved. There is no Sunday night live this week, or not through the whole time of Advent and Christmas. And then also a reminder, if you have poinsettias that you would like to give to the church, to give in memory of a loved one, or perhaps for yourself, we're invited to do so. We'd like them delivered to the church by Saturday, December 17th. And then one announcement that didn't make the bulletin, a prayer concern. This is for Jamie Halls. She's had a lot of trouble with her back. She goes in tomorrow again for some more testing to be done. And then she goes in on the 13th to have an injection into a major vein. So we want to pray for her. She feels like they're heading in the right direction, at least, so pray for her as she's trying to get through that back pain. One other announcement for a prayer concern, and you may have heard over the weekend up in Sioux Falls, there was a building that collapsed, and one of the workers was in the building that was not able to get out and passed and died was Ethan McMahon, so we want to pray for both him and his family this weekend as they have to deal with his loss of life. And then also on our prayer chain of concerns, one update on there would be for Dale Eads, and he is recuperating now at home following his surgery. Are there any other joys or concerns? If not, let us stand and greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ.
Please join me in the call to worship taken from Luke 1, 27b to 33. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great, and we will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end."
We light this candle to remember that God's ways are not our ways, that like Mary we have doubts, but when we understand the power of the Holy Spirit and that nothing is impossible with God, We will respond like Mary did. I am the Lord's servant. Please join me in the congregational response.
Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we thank you that your ways are not our ways. May you, holy child of Bethlehem, descend to us. We pray, cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. May we, like Mary, and put may we be like Mary and put our faith in you, that through the power of the Holy Spirit we might receive Christ to work in us and bring us the hope of glory. Amen.
Confession. God of our salvation,
you straighten the winding ways of our hearts and smooth the paths made rough by sin. We confess that we have not watched for your coming into the world and have missed the signs of your kingdom in our midst. Our commitment to truth
Friends, hear the good news. Although we are unworthy, we are granted God's favor in Jesus Christ and baptized into the church of his blood Son. Friends, believe in the good news. In Jesus' name, we are forgiven. This time we'll have a special music by the praise team.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Christian Education Committee would just like to let you know that we're looking for a few new members to join us starting in March. And we just thought we'd take a little minute just to tell you what the committee does, because a lot of times you're asked to maybe be on a committee and you don't even know what they do. So we're going to share a little bit of that with you.
We have a great group of people that work together, and we enjoy making decisions regarding youth and adult education in the church. Right now, we have a few things that we assist with, which is Logos, FLC, Sunday School, Right Now Media, Teacher Appreciations, the library, camper trips, and presentation of Bibles to our students. We would love to have you as part of our team, and if this sounds like something you would like to try, please talk to one of us.
And we're also looking for a couple of people to be our Bible school directors. They actually would be the co-directors this summer, 2017, with two other people who are the directors. So there's really four people working together. And then they, for 2018, would move up into that position of director. So if you think this is something you'd be interested, maybe you and a friend would like to do it together, please let either Darla or I know. Thank you.
Morning. Today, following the service, the FOC will be hosting an omelet brunch in plans of fundraising for our 2017 Rocky Mountain High trip. We'll be serving omelets, pancakes, smokies, milk, juice, and coffee. And you are all welcome to come.
Our Old Testament reading, found in Genesis 12, 1 through 3, and Genesis 22, 15 to 19. The Lord has said to Abram, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all the people on earth will be blessed through you." The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, "I swear myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this, that you have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me." Then Abraham returned to his servants, and they set off together for Beersheba, and Abraham stayed in Beersheba. Now our first gospel reading, Matthew 1, 1 through 3, 5 through 6, and 16 through 17. A record of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, Judah the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar, Perez the father of Hezron, and Hezron the father of Ram. Solomon was the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Boaz the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David. David was the father of Solomon, whose mother had been Uriah's wife. And Jacob the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, for whom was born Jesus, who is called the Christ. Thus there are 14 generations in all, from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile of Babylon, and 14 from the exile to the Christ.
Please stand and join for our song of preparation.
Your baby boy would one day walk.
Please stay standing for our second gospel reading, found in Luke 1, 26 through 38. And I will be reading from the English Standard Version. Hear the word of the Lord. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And when he came to her, he said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child will be born, will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who is called barren, for nothing is impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. Here ends the reading of the Lord. You may be seated. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, open our ears to hear your words and to know your voice. Speak to our hearts and strengthen our wills that we may serve you today, tomorrow, and always. In Jesus' holy name, amen. When I was in middle school, I had a few classes that we had to find out more about who we were. In one of these classes, we had to find where our ancestors came from. This project didn't seem too hard at first. But once we found what country our distant relatives came from, we couldn't find much more information after that. Even asking parents and grandparents, their memories and records could go only so far back. And in the other class, we had to make our family tree, which proved the same difficulties. The records could go only so far back. Books and records like that do only go so far back, and so most of our reports only went through a handful of generations. In recent years, different groups like Ancestry.com have been popping up and helping people to go back to find their family line. In some of these cases, the people had shared how they thought they belonged to only one race or nationality. But after testing and research, they found that they could have family lines from different areas around the world that their ancestors had come from. Although there are some experts and people who doubt the validations of these tests and sites, there is one thing that is certain. People want to know who they are and where they come from. We might not be able to go back very far in our own family lines, but there is a lineage that was promised to happen way back in Genesis. When God is speaking to Abraham in Genesis 22, he says, "I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies. And through your offsprings, all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me." We see that this promise is answered through the genealogy of Jesus, as we read part of it in our first gospel reading in Matthew today. We see that the promise of Abraham is fulfilled through the birth of Jesus Christ. But there is another genealogy of Jesus listed in Luke 3. And Luke takes it all the way back to Abraham and God. Adam and then God. But if you compare the two lists in Matthew and Luke, you can see one is much shorter and that there's names that differ after King David and up to Joseph. Many experts today believe that both lists are still right, even though the names are different. Some of their beliefs is that the names from Matthew are from Joseph's family line, Jesus' adopted and legal father. Whereas in Luke, Jesus' blood relatives are listed through Mary's line. In Greek, there isn't a word for son-in-law, so Joseph is listed there instead of Mary. It is good to know that in the time of Jesus, marriage and relation had a different approach than it does to today. So what does this mean for us today? It shows us that God's promise was fulfilled to Abraham. It also shows that Matthew and Luke cover it from the different sides of the family. But it also shows some other interesting information. If you look closely, there are some big names in that list. And looking more closely at the Matthew passage, we see names like Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Judah, and we also see King David and Solomon. Many of these names you probably recognize. And they would be especially a big name for a Jewish family like Jesus is. Most people would expect to see the names of kings and leaders chosen by God in Jesus' genealogy. But Matthew throws in some other names as well that I'm sure many people would rather have keep out. I have also read the book Hidden Christmas by Timothy Keller. And Keller brings up some interesting facts about the other side of Jesus' family line. He writes that a genealogy is like a resume, especially in that time, and maybe some of us can still relate to that today. So a genealogy is a way of saying to the world, this is who I am. Matthew does show some big names in Jesus' resume, but he also does something completely out of the ordinary. First, he lists 5 different women in the genealogy of Jesus. Today, that might not seem that a big deal because we list our mothers, our grandmothers, and other relatives like that. But in ancient patriarchal society, the women's name was never given in such a list, as we saw in the Luke passage. And second, 3 of these women were Gentiles, Tamar, Rahab, and Ruth. Yet God uses them to fulfill his promise. And the last thing is these women and the men and the family that they were married into brought back some of the most immoral instances in the Bible. For example, when Matthew writes of King David, the father of Solomon, we think those are pretty big and special names, but he adds whose mother had been Uriah's wife. He could have said Bathsheba, but he chose to say Uriah's wife. This brings back the story of how King David looked upon Uriah's wife, Bathsheba, and wanted her. He then made it possible that Uriah was sent to the battlefront to be killed so he could have his wife. All these stories, both the good that they bring and the bad, make up Jesus' family line. God's son had some great names in there, but he also had some people that brought bad memories to the people of Israel. There was many who had dysfunctional families and was something that most people didn't seek out. Well, maybe some of us feel that like that today. Maybe we have family whose name is known all throughout the community for doing great things, and we don't feel we live up to that name. Or maybe we have a family's name who had made mistakes in the past, and we feel embarrassed and ashamed to be part of that family. And some of us might not even know who our family is, and we feel like a piece of us is missing. Jesus might have some great people in his name, but he also had people who didn't have the best pedigree or made mistakes just like us. Yet look what Jesus did in his life that he led. Well, this might seem impractical for some of us because Jesus is a perfect human being and the Son of God, and we are just sinful human beings. When we look at the genealogy, we often think of Jesus. But that same lineage is the same of a young, poor teenage girl named Mary. Whether it's through marriage on Matthew's side list or in Luke through her blood relatives, Mary is the mother of Jesus. When we hear her name, many of us think of someone like this. Even non-believers know Mary's name, and often through paintings like this one. She is often shown as a regal, adult woman with flowing robes. But in reality, Mary became pregnant, she wouldn't have been more than a young teen. During that legal time for marriage, for girls was 12 and 13 for boys. And the engagement process lasted for over a year. And the bride was considered the groom's legal bride for that whole time. And after the engagement, they would get married. Since she was engaged to Joseph, she had at least be 12 years old, but is often thought she was anywhere from the age of 12 to 14 when she was pregnant with Jesus. It's also thought that she came from a poor peasant family in Nazareth. So not only is she a young teen, she's most likely poor and already engaged to be married. How would you think Mary would have taken the news that Gabriel told her? If we were to ask, what would she say? And the angel, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. Throughout the passage, we see that Mary is troubled and that she has some doubts. She doesn't understand why God chooses her and how this would be possible. Granted, I think any of us would be a little confused if an angel came to us. Would we believe what the angel said, or would we think we are going crazy? Some of her doubts are realistic. How could she get pregnant? She was a virgin. And I can imagine some other doubts she might have that are realistic. If this happens to me, what will become of my life? Will my family disown me? Will the community cast me out? Will Joseph divorce me? Will I be stoned to death? And some of her doubts are probably faith-based. Why would God choose someone like her, a poor, unwed teen, the bottom of the social ladder? Are Mary's doubts wrong? No, I don't believe so. There are different ways that someone can doubt. There is a kind of doubt that is a sign of a closed mind, and of a kind of a doubt that is of an open mind. Some doubt seeks answers, and some doubt is the defense against possibility of answers. Mary's question to Gabriel is kind of a doubt that leads to answers. And Gabriel recognizes this, and he reassures her by saying, "And the angel answered her, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the 6 months with her who is called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God.'" Gabriel recognizes that Mary has these doubts, but they were not the doubts of a closed mind. His words break any doubts that she once had, and she committed to her answer. I'm sure she still had these thoughts in her mind of, if she agreed to God's calling, that it could lead to divorce, being outcast from the community and her family and friends, or even death. And if Joseph decided to stay with her, there would still be rumors going around, for she would be pregnant before their legal wedding. Even with all of this, a young, poor girl from a small community was going to become the mother of Jesus to fulfill God's promise to Abraham. And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed her. So in what ways can we have the same faith as Mary? A young, poor teen with a questionable family background. Well, I'm assured that I do not have to be perfect to listen to God's calling, and that it could come at any time, because God has used many people of questionable backgrounds in our history. For our backgrounds, social standings, race, nationality mean nothing in the face of God. We have all been adopted by our Heavenly Father and made new in Him through His Son, Jesus Christ. So during this Advent and Christmas season, let us open our hearts, even if we have those doubts like Mary did. And let us hear God's plans for us. Let us have faith like Mary's, and let God's will be done. Amen. Let us pray. God of generations, your promise comes to birth in surprising ways. Fill our hearts with courage and hope, and fill our dreams with visions of new life, so that we may live according to your word and love with the fullness of your grace. In the holy name of Jesus, our Savior, we pray for those in need of God's healing hand. For Dale Eads, who's recovering at home after emergency surgery. For Mary Leathers, who is now a member of Sibley Specialty Care. For Gary Abels, who is recovering from a broken hip, and Gertrude Abels, recovering from knee surgery. For Lois Balkman's daughter, Pam, who is still fighting cancer once again. for Diblett Wills, who's back at home after his hospitalization. And Lynn Wills was pray for strength and comfort. And Eliza Jansma, who has an appointment with his doctor coming up as he still battles for cancer. We also pray for the families of Dolores Helmers and of Ruth Kroll, and those family members and friends of who passed away in Sioux Falls, and all those who have lost loved ones. We give you praise for new life and for baptism that will be taking later place today. We also pray for those who serve in distant lands, working and serving in harm's way. Assure them of your loving presence. We pray for them who have worked for peace and to bring help for those in need. Might their gifts be a tangible reminder that your enduring love. We pray for those now serving in their country as those who have in the past. May we strive to be your true disciples of Jesus Christ, praying the prayer that he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For it is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
At this time, I'd like to invite the families down for the baptism this morning for both Matt and Rachel, and then any of the children that want to come down and have a seat up front to be able to see to come forward at this time as well. Hear these words of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He said, All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, even to the end of age. And so, obeying the word of our Lord Jesus Christ and confident of his promises, we baptize those to whom God has called. In baptism, God claims us and seals us to show us that we belong to God. And God frees us from sin and death and unites us with Jesus Christ and his death and resurrection. By water and the Holy Spirit, we're made members of the church, of the body of Christ, and joined in Christ's ministry of his love, his peace, and his justice. Let us remember with joy our own baptisms as we celebrate this sacrament this morning.
On behalf of the session, I present this child, son of Matt and Rachel Jurgens, to receive the sacrament of baptism.
And I ask this question now of the parents. Do you now wish to have your son baptized in Jesus' name?
I do.
And relying on God's grace, do you promise to live the Christian faith and to teach that faith to your child?
Our Lord Jesus Christ orders us to teach those who are baptized. Do we, the covenant partners of the church, promise to tell this new disciple the good news of the gospel, to help him know all that Christ commands, and by our fellowship to strengthen his family ties with the household of God?
We do.
And through baptism, we enter into the covenant that God has established. And within that covenant, God gives us new life, guards us from evil, and nurtures us in love. In embracing that covenant, we choose whom we will serve by turning from evil and turning to Jesus Christ. And to you as parents, as God embraced you within that covenant, I now ask you to reject sin, to profess your faith in Jesus Christ, and to confess the faith of the church, the faith in which we baptize. Here now are those questions. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? And do you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? And will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love? And now with our whole congregation, let us stand and say the Apostles' Creed, and it will be printed on the screens up above. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. We give you thanks, eternal God, for you nourish and sustain all living things by the gift of water. In the beginning of time, your spirit moved over the watery chaos, calling forth order and life. In the time of Noah, you destroyed evil by the waters of the flood and giving righteousness a new beginning. And you led Israel out of slavery and through the waters of the sea into the freedom of the promised land. In the waters of Jordan, Jesus was baptized by John and anointed with your spirit. And by that baptism of his death and resurrection, Christ set us free from sin and death and opened the way to eternal life. We thank you, O God, for the water of baptism, for in it we are buried with Christ in his death, from it we are raised to share in his resurrection, and through it we are reborn by the power of your Holy Spirit. And so we pray, send your Holy Spirit now to move over this water, that it may be a fountain of deliverance and rebirth. Wash away this child's sin and allow him to be cleansed by it. Raise him to new life and graft him into the body of Christ. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon him that he may have the power to do your will and continue forever in the risen life of Christ. Amen. What is the given name of this child? Emmett James Jurgens, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Defend, O Lord, your servant Emmett with your heavenly grace, that he may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more, until he comes into your everlasting kingdom. Amen. Yeah. Let us go ahead and sing our song number 71, Behold What Manner of Love. What love the Father has given to us, that we should be called the sons, the children of God. Let us pray. ever-living God, in your mercy you promise not only to be our God, but also to be the God of our children. We thank you this morning for receiving Emmett by baptism. Keep him always in your love. Guide him as he grows in faith. Protect him from all the dangers and temptations of life. And give his parents wisdom and patience to guide this child in the faith of the church. And bring Emmett to confess Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior, and to be his faithful disciple until life's end. Amen. I'll let you give. We have a couple of gifts for you. These are gifts that he could actually use to feed him if he wanted to, physically. But in reality, they are a spiritual gift and a reminder that you not only will feed him physically, but to feed him spiritually in the life of the church and in the faith of Jesus Christ. And so we give you this as a gift. And we also have a baptismal candle for him, and then the baptismal certificate. So congratulations. Yep, congratulations. Yep, I know. All right. Okay, you guys may be seated, and the children may go back to their seats, too.
At this time, we'll continue our worship by giving our gifts and our tithes. For the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to one does not have.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, through your prophets, you have promised us a world where justice and mercy would reign, where knowledge and understanding would prevail, and where the poor and the weak would be the recipients of compassion, not scorn. You sent Christ to give us the vision of this kind of kingdom, then gave us the Holy Spirit within us that we might work to make our way for it in our world. As we give our gifts this morning, may you dedicate them to us to help bring out a world where your love, mercy, and grace is shown. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's continue to stand for our closing song, Go Tell It on the Mountain.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching or silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed the Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. In a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born, and God sent the salvation that blessed Christmas born. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
Before we go out, just an announcement that the FOC would like you to go ahead and be seated, and then they will dismiss you for the brunch this morning.
As we go from this place, renewed in your faith and filled with the Holy Spirit, go and tell it on the mountain. Share God's love, which has been shared graciously with you. Amen.